ophthalmology practice and performed eye surgery for 18 years. As a hardworking and dedicated physician, not a career politician, Rand Paul came to Washington to shake things up and make a difference. He grew up in Lake Jackson, Texas, where he attended Baylor University for undergrad and graduated from Duke Medical School in 1980. Upon completion of his medical training in 1993, Rand and Kelly moved to Bowling Green to start their family and begin his ophthalmology practice. Dr. Paul's entrance into politics is indicative of his life's work as a surgeon, a desire to diagnose problems and provide practical solutions, whether it be in Bowling Green, Kentucky, or in Washington, D.C. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Senator Rand.
We borrow money from China to send it to Pakistan. Is that crazy?
Yeah.
Insane. We borrow money from China, to send it to Pakistan, to send it to Egypt, to send it to Libya, you name it. So when we had a big thing going on with the Muslim Brotherhood took over Egypt, I said, well, it doesn't sound like they're our friends. Just guessing, all right? So let's cut off sending them tanks and arms and planes and billions of dollars that we must borrow from China first. You know how many votes I had? 22 people voted with me, all Republicans, and about 25 Republicans voted no, and every Democrat voted to keep sending your money to Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. That's what's wrong with your country. Your representatives aren't representing you. None of you want that, and yet your senators and congressmen keep voting to send this money around the world. I introduced another amendment to the Foreign Relations Committee. It said that we shouldn't send money, any money, to countries that persecute Christians, and we defined that by...
All right.
I'm not just making up what that means. We defined it by the death penalty being persecution. Sounds like persecution. Death penalty or life imprisonment for interfaith marriage, changing your religion, or saying something critical about the state religion. About 25 countries that have those laws on the books, and they do enforce them, and yes, you do send money to them. In Pakistan, there's a woman by the name of Asia Bibi. She went to draw water from the well, and as she did, the women of the village and the men of the village began beating her with sticks and stoning her. As she lay bleeding on the ground, yelling and crying out for help, the police finally came and arrested her. They accused her of being critical of the state religion. She sits on death row in Pakistan while you continue to plow money, billions after billions, into Pakistan. You know what? We've got some problems at home. Why don't we look at vetoing America? People sometimes ask me, what's the worst thing the president's doing in the country? And I tell them, how long do you have? I've got a long list, but I can talk a long time. But if I wanted to sum it all up, it isn't just Obamacare, which was terrible for the country. It wasn't just the banking regulations that's killing the ability of businesses, local businesses, to get loans, or homeowners to get loans. If you want to sum it all up, what the president is doing to the country, that's right, he needs to live, just step a little. Would y'all like him back?
No!
But we want to know what the worst thing he's done. It's the collapse of the separation of powers. He's gobbling up and grabbing all the power for the presidency for unelected bureaucrats, and we're going to stop it. Yeah. One of the greatest things our founders gave us was that they divided the power. We're supposed to have co-equal branches of government. And Madison did the ambition against ambition. The ambition of Congress to try to get more power, against the president to try to get more power, against the judiciary. And they would check and balance each other. Hadn't been working so well for us. This president got defeated in Congress, in the House, and in the Senate. Now he says, I've got my phone, I've got my pen, I'm just going to do whatever the hell I want. That's a problem. Montesquieu described it this way. Montesquieu was one of the philosophers that our founders looked to and helped us with the idea of the political branches. Montesquieu said that when the executive, the president, when the executive begins to legislate, a form of tyranny will ensue. That's what we're facing, my friends. We're facing a form of tyranny. We won't call him a tyrant. All right, we won't go there. But the thing is, this is the fear when so much power gravitates into the hands of one person. And it's not just this president. It happened with the previous president. You got a Republican president, Republican Congress, they say, give them more power. That's our God. Our God. Give them more power. Republicans have been guilty of this as well. Your congressmen and your senators are guilty because they give up the power. If we fought tooth and nail and said, we're not going to let that happen, we could stop them. I think every regulation is being made. The regulatory code may be hurting businesses more than the taxes. It's just as long. Tens of thousands of pages of regulatory code, and you know what? I don't agree to vote on any of it. The thing on greenhouse gases, we should debate, and Congress should vote on it. He's going to do this by royal edict. An unelected bureaucrat does this, and we have no way to stop it. This is a real problem. So not only do you need a new president, you largely need a new, stronger, and more constitutional Congress. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's tough to win in the bigger states when you have bigger turnout in presidential tiers. And it's very simple law. We don't get enough African American votes. We have to get more African American voters for them to win. That's why I was here 3 weeks ago on the south side of Chicago with an African American minister who has his own private school down there, who many of the people I met that day came up to me and said one thing about Chicago. The money allocated for the poor never reaches the poor. Okay. It's gobbled up by the Chicago machine. You got to be aware of somebody. Yeah. So I've got a proposal for the people who live on the south side of Chicago or for anybody that hasn't been paying attention to us. We're going to help alleviate poverty. We're going to help alleviate joblessness. But we're not going to do what the Democrats have done. The Democrats have been gobbling up your money since the 1960s, since the war of poverty began, and then sending it back. Problem is, there's people in the middle gobbling and eating their fair share before it gets back to the places of poverty. What I want to do is the opposite. Not take your money and then send it back. Never take your money to begin with. Leave it in the community. For those who live in poverty, even above and beyond our flat tax. It's called economic freedom zones. If you have high unemployment and chronic high poverty, we'll cut your taxes to almost nothing for 10 years. It adds up to a large amount of money. For the south side of Chicago, it'll be nearly $3 billion over 10 years. We have to have a debate in our country about how jobs are created to create them. There are two parts to the economy. The productive economy, and I'm looking at it. And if you want to see the non-productive economy, look at Congress. They don't make anything. They don't produce anything. They consume your hard-earned dollars. And it makes no sense to send anybody to Washington and say, oh, come back to Chicago and give us stuff. You know what happens? They give it to their cronies. They give it to their contributors. Anybody ever heard of Solyndra?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
This is one of the richest men in our country. Why would we be loaning tax dollars to a very wealthy guy? He should go to the bank and get his own money.
Right.
Yep.
Something called democratic capitalism. Every day someone votes on whether Royal Kitchen and Bath succeeds. Every day they come through the door and they vote. If they buy his stuff here, Chris will succeed. If they don't, he won't. It's harsh, but that's the way business works. But we know after a few years, he's been in business 10 years, he's doing something right. So if we lower the taxes for a business that exists and has a voice to tell something, we know it's going to productive use. What if I take your money and I come back and I say, oh, Mr. Smith, you'd be good at running a business. Here's $1 million, start a business. I have no idea when that person's good at business. That's what the marketplace figures out. So imagine dollar for dollar, When we borrow $1 billion from China and we pass it out to somebody, when we select Visa because they're a political donor, versus giving it back to people who you've already voted for by going to their business. We're talking about a stimulus that would create millions and millions of jobs. Was Ronald Reagan cut taxes? That's what happened. But it's been since Ronald Reagan, since we've had a Republican who seriously and honestly and forthrightly wanted to cut your taxes. We need a nominee who will cut taxes and cut the government. They want revenue-neutral tax reform. Anybody here going to knock on a door for a politician who wants revenue-neutral?
No!
It means that half of you will pay more, and half of you will pay less, and the net result in the economy is zero. I'm not leaving my practice. If that's what it was for, I'm going home. I've got no time to be for nothing. We should be for cutting taxes and making government smaller, growing the productive sector and doing jobs. To win again, we don't need to dilute what we stand for. We need to be more boldly for what we are for. But we also have to reach out to new constituencies. Almost everybody in the Republican Party, including all 55 candidates for president, are probably pretty decent on the Second Amendment. If you don't believe me, come to my house on an X, alright? But we're doing pretty well there. What about some of the other amendments that might attract new people to our party? The Fourth Amendment is your right to be left to run. A dust up on the presidential stage next week because there's a lot of Republicans. I can think of two or three who, it's their favorite thing about President Obama is collecting all your phone records. They love it and they compliment the president about collecting your phone records. Well, I've got a better plan. Let's collect more records of terrorists and less records of
individuals.
Advocate, but if I'm the judge and they say there's a terrorist in there and I have X amount of information, doesn't have to be proof. Has to be some suspicion and information. They call me at 3 in the morning and say, go in and get the records. Same with murderers, same with rapists. All of the bad things that have been happening while we're collecting records of everyone. The Boston bombing occurred while we collected all of your records. The Chattanooga shooting just recently happened. We're still collecting records. It has not stopped. Remember Major Hassan Fort Hood? We were collecting all of your records. And guess what? In every instance, we had some suspicion, but we weren't doing anything about it. The Russians tipped us off to the Boston bomber. Major Hassan was writing crazy stuff about killing Americans and Christians for a dozen years, and nobody stopped him. We kept promoting him. His role was afraid to fire somebody. That's a whole other story to tell. We can't fire people from the VA who are lying about waiting time. We found people at the EPA who are downloading porn 6 hours a day, and you said, well, they're fired, right? You can't fire anybody. They found one guy at the EPA, a guy named, blanking on his name, but he was a second-hand man to Eugene McCarthy at the very top. You know what he was doing? For 11 years, he never was coming to work. He kept getting promoted. They said, why? They asked his boss, they said, well, he's in the CIA.
Yeah.
I'm like, really? So they did something for him. They called the CIA. You know what the CIA said? Jonathan knew. So I imagine what he was doing for 11 years. Had to have a swimming pool because he made a lot of money. Laid by a swimming pool, he's drinking a beer. When his boss calls and says, are you coming in? He's like, no, I mean, it's done. When are we going to be a bigger party? We got to amend the whole Bill of Rights, Second Amendment, Fourth Amendment, Fifth and Sixth Amendment, Amendments of Justice. Government should never take your property from one private property owner and give it to another. Rights are not relative. We've got a rights to recreate, and I'll be damned if I'm going to let the government take them away. The 19th Amendment says that those rights not listed in the Bill of Rights are not to be disparaged. It's a small listing of your rights. Your rights are unenumerated, they're infinite, they come from our Creator, we don't believe in God, they're still yours naturally. The government can't take them away. And the powers that we gave to the federal government are limited and enumerated. And what we didn't give to the federal government are left to the people of the states. We shouldn't allow government to keep bottling up power. The Sixth Amendment says that you have a right to trial by jury. And you think, well, who could possibly oppose that? We passed a bill a couple years ago that allows American citizens to be indefinitely detained without a trial, without a lawyer. And but when you think about it, you think, oh, there's bad people. Maybe you're confused with bad people. They have a list of the criteria for people you're supposed to report, your neighbor that you're supposed to turn in. People with missing fingers, people who have stains on their clothing. They might be a bomb maker for missing fingers and stains on their clothes. Or they might be a monk. Or a bad coffee drinker. You're supposed to turn in people who have changed the color of their hair. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. You're all supposed to be suspicious of people who have multiple guns in the household, or weatherproof ammunition, or like to pay in cash. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands there. But if these are the criteria, I want my lawyer before they come to my house. The thing is we have to be very careful that in our ability to protect ourselves from terrorism, we don't give up on who we are. There's a young man in my neighboring town, my wife and I helped with a house tour through this veterans group. He lost both legs and an arm. And when you ask him what he fought for, he says the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. Wouldn't it be sad if Romney was gone, defending his country, and he came back and we had given up on the Bill of Rights? That's our job. If you're not fighting, you need to be here defending the Bill of Rights. The Sixth Amendment says you have a right to a speedy trial. Philippe Brower was a 16-year-old black kid from the Bronx, accused of a crime. Incidentally, for someone who did not live in this country and wasn't here legally and never showed up for trial. He spent 3 years in prison, 2 years in solitary confinement, tried to commit suicide, and then just about a month ago did commit suicide. This shouldn't happen in America. And if you want a bigger party, what I'm saying to you is let's defend the Sixth Amendment just as much as the Second Amendment. It's for minorities. People say, well, I'm not a minority. You can be a minority because of the color of your skin or the shade of your ideology. You can be a minority because you're an evangelical Christian, because you teach your kids at home, maybe even because you believe in your Constitution. The thing is, we want to protect individual rights. That means having your day in court, having a lawyer. We've done some things in our country that have gotten out of control. We are putting people in jail for nonviolent drug crimes. Decades. Some people for life. But it's even worse than that. When you look at the people arrested for marijuana, it's 15-1 black for white. You say, well, maybe they're smoking more dope. But they're 10% of the population, and when you do surveys, white kids are smoking pot too. They just live in the suburbs, and police aren't there. kind of blame the police. The police are patrolling the city with more people back together. And just over time, our jails become full of African American Hispanics. If you want them to consider our party, let's be the party of justice. There's a painter by the name of Robert Henrod, and he said to young painters, he said, "Paint like a man coming over the hill singing." I love the image of that. I think we've become the party that proclaims our message like a man coming over the hill singing. Proclaims our message with the passion of Patrick Henry, then we're going to dominate, we're going to roll, we're going to win Chicago, we're going to win Illinois, and we're going to win the president. Patrick, to Israel, Chicago.